Let me read 1 Corinthians 3, verses 5 through 17. This is Paul speaking to the Corinthians. What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you believed, as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. He who plants and he who waters are one. Each will receive his wages according to his labor. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building. According to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I lay a foundation, and someone else is building upon it. Let each one take care how he builds upon it. For no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds up a foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest. For the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire. And the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire. Do you not know that you are God's temple, and that God's Spirit dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is holy, and you are that temple. Let's pray. Lord God, we do pray for your Spirit to be here and to teach. Lord, we recognize that you are the one who has taught all along and has given us understanding, given us a heart to believe and to receive and to hear. And so we pray that you would give us hearts to hear, eyes to see, and give us understanding for your word. Lord, we do pray for our dear friends worshiping at home that you would give them access in the midst of their exile in place. We pray, Lord, that you would continue to build up your church through this awkward and weird time. And we trust that you are at that work and more committed to it than we are. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, 3 points this morning about God's mission. First of all, God's mission is about building a temple. The second is that God is zealous for building that temple. And the third is that he does all this by actually building up his workers. So temple, zeal, and workers. First, God's mission is about building a temple for his loving presence in the church to be installed for the sake of the world. We'll make sense of that in just a second. But what I want to say is to really understand this passage, we actually have to start at the end. Let me read verses 16 and 17 to you again. Paul says, "Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him. For God's temple is holy. You are that temple." Well, what does it mean to be a temple? A temple is actually the Old Testament word for God's home. Or another word for God's temple in the Old Testament is house. David says he wants to build a house for the Lord. And the Lord says, no, I'll build my own house. The temple is where the Spirit of God dwells. It's where all of God's own life, his presence, the warmth, the joy, the fellowship of God himself comes and lives, makes himself known. God goes out of his way to make his home with us. That's what this language means. To be God's temple means that we are in communion with God, that he's living with us. And all of what Paul says about this is the gospel truth of Christmas. God with us. Jesus became human. And now his Spirit is with us. God has not abandoned us, but actually he's made his home among us. And so all of the talk we have about God's forgiveness and baptism, really, all of that flows from God's desire to come and live in your house. To live in your body. To be among us, to have communion. God makes his home with sinners and calls us children. That's the gospel. Amen?
Amen.
And that's actually what is motivating all of what Paul is saying in this passage. He does this, first of all, by gathering us. God makes us a temple by gathering us. You know, the problem with English now, modern English, is that we don't use y'all in translations. Y'all is a perfectly serviceable grammatical construction. Thank you, South American states. But what Paul says in verses 16 and 17 is actually plurals. Every time you see a you in the Bible, you can pretty much assume it's going to be a plural. He says, do you not know that y'all, you-ins, are God's temple? And that God's Spirit dwells in y'all. Or yiz, I think is the Scottish term, yeah? There you go. Any kind of second or first plural will do the job. Paul says that it's our corporate gathering as a church, which is actually where God most particularly dwells. It's in who we are as a gathered body, as a community, where God is most made known. We were alienated and wandering, and God gathered us into his home. God gathered us into a body together, and so together we are his temple. But also we have to notice that he's gathering them, but Paul's writing a letter to Corinth, right? Corinth is fairly far from Jerusalem, if you didn't know. Corinth is a long way off. So God is gathering up the alien people of the world and building them into temples, and yet what? He's installing them in every little location scattered across the globe. You know, from airplane windows when you fly at night, it's really cool when you come in over the sea and then you come to the land. You can see where the land starts, right? Because there's lights at the land. And the lights mark out the edge of the land, and you can see them strung across the coast, and then you can see them creeping back into the valleys with each community. And each one of those little gatherings of light, when you look down from the airplane, you know, is a community. It's a community because light always marks shared life and investment. We're going to build street lights because that's where we live. Let's see what we're doing. That is a great image of the church. Little communities of God's Spirit building up his presence in every nook and cranny of the earth, in every valley, across every coastline. God's temple being installed in every little location, every corner, so that God's presence fill the earth as the waters cover the face of the sea. That's what God's up to with the church. That's what God's up to. And by the way, he's already done it. Right? We forget this. We're in Scotland, we're worshiping, and yet what? There are believers in Nigeria. Amen? There are believers in North America even. There are believers in North Korea. See, nothing's going to stop God spreading his presence across the world. Even governments who hate him, doesn't matter. God's up to something, and no one will stop him. That's the beauty of the gospel. That's the beauty of the church. But what I want to ask is, what does it mean that God calls us as a church a temple? And how does that do anything about the mission? And the answer is that God's people have always been a vehicle for his blessing. I don't know if you remember the call to Abraham that God gives. He says, in you, all the families of the earth will be blessed. Blessed. Goodness, joy, life comes through God's people as they make home in the midst of the nations. You know, evangelism is really important. We focus on it. And what a premier gift it is to come to know God and be saved. But what Paul is saying is that evangelism is never alone. Evangelism in the Bible is never presented alone as something that's just good to do. Evangelism is always the outflow of our life as the temple, as the place where God's Spirit is dwelling and making things known. So, God blesses the world by the way he cares for the people of the church. Let me read this verse to you from Ephesians 3:10. This is one that caught my eye, and I've never forgotten it. It's so wild. Ephesians 3:10 tells us that it's through the church that the manifold wisdom of God is made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. You believe that? That God's manifold wisdom. If we're going to find somewhere to really point out God's wisdom, the place Paul tells us to look is the local church with all of its mess, all of its problems, all of its dysfunctional people, right? Paul says, yep, that's the place where God's wisdom is unfolded for the world to see. Why? Because it's in our nitty-grittiness. It's in the troubles that we make for ourselves as a community, as we bump elbows, as you make me mad, as I make you mad, as we forgive each other. Actually, it's in our interactions as a church, as a body, as we bear each other's burdens, that God's Spirit is most at. That God's wisdom, this profound wisdom, is most made known. Wow, God would save sinners and make a home with them? Why? So that he could demonstrate his own character. That he's patient. That he's a shepherd. That he's tender. That he's compassionate. He's long-suffering. The church is God's brilliant idea to make himself known. So, God's doing this with the church. I want you to see that, first of all. But second, I want you to see that God is zealous for the church's edification. I don't know if you caught how seriously Paul or God takes building up the church. And you might have missed it because it's part of those verses that we usually want to avoid in this passage. Right? It's the verses that make us feel uncomfortable trying to read through really quickly and move on and find the good stuff. And that's okay, but it's often those verses that scare us the most that we probably need to press into a little bit more. Is there something going on there? I want you to hear these just one more time. Not to whip ourselves, but to find that God's doing something. Listen to this in verse 17. If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him. That's a serious warning. That is a warning. And it's weighty. But, if we push deeper, we also see that first and foremost, before it's a warning, it's about God's zeal for his people. God is so zealous for his people that he's like a mama bear, right? You mess with my kids, you better back up, right? You mess with my kids, you mess with me. Parents, you know what I'm talking about? Right? You find that your kids have been bullied at school, you're like, okay. You harm my kids, I'm going to harm you. Maybe not, but I want to. Look, you have to see God's zeal in this passage. It's all over. He's zealous for his people. What's he zealous for? Well, he's zealous for holiness. Right? Verse 17 continues. For God's temple is holy, and y'all are that temple. God is zealous for our shared community to be one that treasures him. Where he is held sacred. Where we're marked by a purity of devotion for him. God's zealous that holiness would mark us, but he's also zealous and eager for fruitfulness or growth. Paul has this image of a crop, right? Verse 6 and 7. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. Neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything but only God who gives the growth. In fact, he says, you are God's field in verse 9. You're a farm. God's zeal is for your growth. Not just like growth just because growth is great, right? Like acceleration. What is the image of a crop? What do you do with crops? Eat them. They're good. They taste good. They bring blessing. They nourish you. They're good for your community. The image of the church is actually a field that produces goods that bless the world. God is eager that the church would be a place that produces good fruit for the world, blessing for the world. So how does God go about that growth? And here's what's weird about this passage. Here's what strikes most of us, especially given that we've grown up in the West and we've embraced a fairly individualist view of Christianity. Most of us have just been given that, and it's not our fault, it's just in the water. Paul says some things here that should strike us. In verses 9 through 10, Paul offers an image of a building, and he says that it's a collaborative building project. That the people of God are actually meant to build each other up into the temple. Right? He says, you are God's building according to the grace of God given to me. Like a skilled master builder, I lay a foundation. Someone else is building upon it. Let each one take care of how he builds upon it. So, we're given gifts to build up each other. Joey is working on the posts and the joists, right? And Sandra's doing the sheetrock and the plaster, right? But then there's Leroy. Leroy's in charge of the plumbing. Leroy didn't really think through the job. The plumbing's always leaking, right? It's sitting on the opposite side of where it should be. Man, Leroy, you did the plumbing, but it's kind of haphazard. We are given gifts to build each other up, and God's eagerness for our growth, his love for his children, means that he actually seeks out what's best. Paul says that we have to admit there's a clear difference in the quality of work that we do, even in ministry. That grace actually doesn't make us dishonest. We can honestly evaluate things. God is so zealous in his love for his people, the church across the world, that he seeks out the best for his collaborative building project. He wants our best. And there's a sober warning here. We can't avoid it. He says, on the day, which means judgment day, God himself will sift our work. He will test the quality of our investment. And this is about quality, not financial value. That's what the image of a gold and a silver are, right? He says, gold, diamond, silver kind of work will survive the test and last on to eternity. God will establish that work. And he's talking about not about how much money to give, but the quality, the eagerness, the purity of our work. But it says God will discard shoddy work. Now, does this mean that we have to work our way into the kingdom? That if Emma does better work than me, then I don't get into the kingdom? No, not at all. The whole point of this passage is that God has already come down. He's already made his home among us, right? That's how we begin. God has built us into a temple. What Paul's after here is not what do you have to do to get in to God's good graces. No, he's saying you are already in God's good graces. God found you. God chose you. God brought you into his people. So now what? Paul is saying we ought to stop and reflect on how we serve his kingdom. Because God's love always brings its best. Let me give you an example of what this means. In the States, we had this great back garden, and we wanted to have an outdoor party in the summers in Washington. It gets hot in Washington, and like where you can go outside in a t-shirt and enjoy yourself. And I wanted to explain summer to you guys. Scotland, there isn't summer, so. And we got this junky old couch and left it outside for our party. It was fun, and then, you know, the next day it rained, right? So now we have this soggy, junky old couch in our backyard. What are we going to do with this? So we stuck it in the garage, left it there for a while, let it dry out, and we're like, we've got to get rid of this thing. So I brought my dad's truck, threw it in the back of the truck, and drove it to the cherry shop, Goodwill. And I'm in the back of the cherry shop where the guy collects the furniture, and he pops up and looks at it and says, hey man, you can't take this. I was like, why not? Really, you can take this, come on. He's in the charity shop. You take everyone's junk, right? He looks at me. He takes a breath. He looks at me and he goes, do you want this couch? Would you buy this? No. That's why I'm giving it to you, right? That's why I'm giving it to you. I don't want it. I was exposed. But that kind and honest man, I was struck by his maturity. What he exposed and made clear was that I was not given to the charity because of my love for the poor. I was given to the charity because I wanted to use them to get rid of my junk. So I admitted the truth and drove off. And thankfully, in our town, we had a university, and college students often have to provide their own furniture in the States, and so we put it on the curb with the sign that said free, and 3 days later, a couple college guys came and picked it up and drove off, and we were set. The couch was taken care of. But what had been exposed to me is that I don't truly love people when I give them my scraps, and it's easy for me to give them my scraps. It's hard for me to give people my best, especially when it's simply for the sake of love. And in fact, I don't love people well. And we do this in the church. Of course we do. Because we do it everywhere. We do it in our families, right? We do it in missions. I can't tell you how many stories I've heard of missionaries or missions agencies receiving broken appliances from people, broken basketball hoops, broken this and that, because, well, surely, you know, the Africans will want this. Surely they can find something to do with it. No. Global Church doesn't want your broken stuff. They want real partnership. They want real partnership. Loving partnership. Well, why do we do this? Why do I bring my junky couches to charity shops? Why do we offer our scraps to the church and to God's kingdom? Well, it's not always malicious, but a lot of it mostly becomes because we've forgotten how costly God's love was for us. We forget how precious and to what lengths the Lord has gone to care for us. God expects us to give our best for each other. That's what this passage is really about. Because he has given his best for us. Right? Just consider your own story for a second. How God has gone out of his way to care for you. Not only to bring you into his people, to forgive you, and to wash you, but to train you, to invest in you, to comfort you, to provide for you. When all of a sudden that weird check came out of nowhere and you couldn't pay your bills, then you could. God has shown up for you in so many ways. In your own life. Not to mention the fact that he has brought his own best. He did not give us sloppy, half-baked love. He gave us his son. Like, that's a really precious, tender gift. The son who he loved from all eternity. Jesus is the one whom the Father delighted in. And he said, yeah, that's the right gift. That's the right gift. To give my son for them. That's fitting because I love him. We talk about Jesus' suffering on the cross for us, and that's right. But we also have to remember that actually Jesus didn't just come to suffer. He actually came to share his entire life with us. His resurrection life is for us. He doesn't just get us in the door and forgive us. He gives us his life so that he can build us up. So this is all true within our local body, but it's also true for what God's doing across the world in the global church. God zealous for the church to be built up in its local stations across the world. And he does this, last of all, by investing in his workers. And to see this, I just want to finish our time by considering the story of Apollos. God builds up his workers to build up his church. You know, the Corinthian church would have never grown had Apollos not been willing to come and water the seed. He's not from here. He's not from Corinth. Where is he from? Well, let's do a little bit of reading out of Acts 18. Luke says in Acts 18, now a Jew named Apollos, a native of Alexandria, that's northern Egypt, came to Ephesus, that's Turkey, modern-day Turkey. He was an eloquent man, competent in the scriptures. He had been instructed in the way of the Lord. So Apollos grew up in this Jewish home. He no doubt heard the scriptures every day at home and every week in the synagogue. He likely knew them in both Hebrew and Greek because he lives in Alexandria. It's a center of learning. But also, Apollos comes to know Jesus. He comes to know the Lord, and he also receives additional instruction in the Lord. He's taught the scriptures and taught to understand how Jesus is the Messiah. And then he shows up in the story of the early church in Ephesus. And he works alongside Priscilla and Aquila in the synagogue. Luke continues, and being fervent in spirit, he spoke and taught accurately the things concerning Jesus. Though he only knew the baptism of John, he began to speak boldly in the synagogue. So Apollos has this tremendous talent, no doubt because of his rich intellectual heritage, and he apparently is an eloquent and captivating teacher, especially as he teaches about Jesus. But he doesn't have it all down. He doesn't know
about Jesus' baptism of the Holy Spirit. Kind of a big deal. He only knows about John's baptism. He has big holes in his theology. So, turns out that God is happy to use us even when we are only half-formed, half-trained. But God's not content to leave him there. Luke continues, when Priscilla and Aquila heard him, they took him aside and explained to him the way of God more accurately. This woman, Priscilla, and her husband, Aquila, they are Paul's good friends. They're co-laborers. They've been working alongside Paul for years. They know him, they know the gospel well, and they love Apollos well enough to kindly teach him. They have opportunity to finish his theological education and personal formation as a pastor. They explained it in the way of God accurately. That's early church theological education. As Apollos is built up, though, the Lord stirs something in him. It doesn't just stop there. It doesn't say, and then Apollos became a greater teacher. Full stop, Luke moves on. No. As Apollos is invested, this is what happens. He wished to cross to Achaia, that is Greece. And the brothers encouraged him and wrote to the disciples to welcome him. When he arrived, he greatly helped those who through grace had believed, for he powerfully refuted the Jews in public, showing by the scriptures that the Christ was Jesus. The Lord stirs up in him and gives him a vision for something beyond himself. He has this desire to go and bless the churches of Greece in the same way that what? That he has been cared for, that he's been blessed, that he's been invested. So the first point of Apollos' life and why he shows up here in 1 Corinthians is that he was able to invest in Corinth because the Lord had sent him person after person who invested in him. His Jewish parents, the synagogue, the early instruction he got in the scriptures, the special care he received from Priscilla and Aquila. God, in his thoughtfulness, had been lining up people all along the way for Apollos so that he would be a blessing to Corinth. I want you to take a second and consider how the Lord has done that in your life. Who has the Lord sent to you? Various seasons, who took an odd but really nice, wonderful interest in you and blessed you and taught you and walked alongside you. That didn't have to happen. How has he done that this last month? This is the way the Lord works. The second point is that Apollos is the first intercultural theological educator. You know, the culture of Ephesus and the culture of Corinth are about as close as Aberdeen and Norway. Culturally. Right? They all speak the same language, but it's a second language for both of them. We don't know exactly how different they are, but we know that he's crossing a serious cultural boundary. Why does he do this? Because he sees the church in Corinth not as weirdos and strangers. He's not indifferent to his brothers and sisters across the world. He sees them as his family. The needs of Corinth are the needs of my brothers and sisters. And so he shows up. He doesn't brush them aside. But finally, and I think this is probably the most fitting point for all of us here this morning, he recognizes that God has equipped him to be of special help in teaching the scriptures. He takes stock of God's ability to use the ways God has already strengthened him. In a nutshell, what Apollos did is what our family is doing. God has massively blessed and invested in our family. I get so much opportunity to study and be cared for and invested in from lovely, wonderful, thoughtful Christians. Who gets to choose that privilege? The Lord has gifted us with so much. And so much of our desire to go and serve in Malawi has been a recognition that, oh my goodness, the things that are needed there are the things the Lord's blessed us with. Of course we're going to go. How could we not? These are our brothers and sisters. I'm going long, so I'll spare you the stories about the setting in Malawi. But I'll just say this. There is a terrible vacuum, terrible lack of well-trained Christian leaders. There's a terrible lack. As I speak to some of the leaders there, they tell me, you know, it's no surprise that your average church member in Malawi, when they're sick, they call on two people to help them. They call on the pastor, first of all, to pray for them. You know who else they call on? Come on, the witch doctor. Right? Maybe it's not that all crazy. Maybe it's not all that far off from some of the things we do. But the point is to say, there's a lot of discipleship to happen. That needs to happen in our life. Those things, that need, those problems, don't come in a vacuum. One of the people there told me, look, we need more grace-filled leaders. We need leaders who have the gospel, who understand it. They said, the African church is a sleeping giant. It's time to wake up, and it's time to do that by investing in their leaders. That's just the tiniest bit of our story. But what about you? God called you to Africa or Asia? South America? Maybe. Maybe, but first of all, before that ever happens, you're always called locally. And what I really want to encourage you to do is to think about your role in God's kingdom in his collaborative temple building project. How can you invest in the kingdom and offer good gifts? Well, I want to give you three things to think about. Just like Apollos did, to take stock, first of all, and then to hope, and then to offer. Take stock, hope, and offer. Take stock of how much God has loved you, but also how God has particularly loved you. What are the particular ways in which God has cared for and trained you and blessed you and made you into someone who has a particular set of gifts and strengths and passions? Take stock of those things, but then hope that God actually could do something good through those. Take seriously the fact that God actually has loved you in those particular ways because he's actually up to something with those things, with your desire to see children cared for, with your desire to see the church well run, with your desire to reach out to the community, the neighborhood. Man, not everyone has that desire. What does that mean about what the Lord's doing with you? Hope that the Lord is actually able to use that good thing you love and desire for good in the kingdom, for good for your community. And I just want to say, if you begin to take your joys and your passions seriously and submit and trust them to the Lord, you will find that he has already planned good works for you along that journey, along that line. But then finally, offer those things. Bring your goods to the best of your ability out of love for God and for your family. Y'all, the greatest joy and honor we have as believers is not just the Lord has saved us. It's actually he gives us the dignity of being co-laborers with him. God gives us the grand dignity and honor of actually doing good, being a great blessing to his kingdom and to his people.